Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the Heart Failure Television. This session is about the cardiac imaging in heart failure, specifically from the cardiac MRI and CT point of view. With me, we have got two distinguished panelists. Dr. Johan Christopher, he is the Director of Cardiac Imaging at Care Hospital Hyderabad. And we have got Dr. Alpa Bharti, she is the Director of Cardiac Imaging at Wadia Children's Hospital and Holy Family, Mumbai. Welcome.
Thank you.
So what we'll do is we'll start with the cardiac imaging, especially the cardiac MRI in heart failure. Now the clinicians many times get little bogged down with a lot of technological terms in cardiac MRI, and our panelists are going to tell us in the easiest way what it really means and what is its clinical significance. So I'll start with Dr. Alpa. What is the LGE imaging? We talk of a lot of LGE, a late gadolinium enhancement or delayed enhancement imaging. What is this exactly and what clinical information does it give?
Okay, late gadolinium enhancement is like the backbone of cardiac MR. It is done after giving contrast, which is the gadolinium. Now it's a large molecule and it is in a normal cell membrane. It will not diffuse into the cell membrane because it is a large molecule. So it remains within the vascular space or into the extracellular space. What happens when the myocardium is damaged, the myocardial cells are damaged. So either it is an acute injury where the cell membrane becomes very permeable. So the contrast molecules of the gadolinium may diffuse into the cellular tissue. That is one in the acute setting. When you have a chronic setting, the contrast with molecules will go into the extracellular space and continue to remain there without being washed out. In chronic injuries, the collagen tissue increases, the extracellular volume increases because the cells have gone down. So the contrast remains in this portion of the myocardium, either within the cells or in the increased extracellular space, rather than getting washed off at a normal time. So when we do a late gadolinium enhancement and we see the persistence of contrast in this damaged myocardium, you know that this is an area of myocardial injury, either acute or chronic. Now, late gadolinium also has the advantage of having different patterns of enhancement. Either it is subendocardial, mid-myocardial, subepicardial. So you can identify the diseases and also prognosticate it. For example, a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you can quantify the scar. In ischemic heart disease, you can quantify the scar. So it gives a lot more information. It gives you the exact extent of injury and the disease also, which, you know, it may be a clinical dilemma at times.
Yeah, excellent. So here we are looking at the grayscale images and we are calling what is white is probably dead or a replacement fibrosis.
Yes.
So now since we are moving away from the grayscale imaging into beautiful parametric maps, we come across the reports of T1 maps, T2 maps, extracellular volume maps. So I will ask Dr. Johan, how are these maps generated and what clinical information we get over and above our grayscale imaging?
Yes, so T1 mapping is a multi-parametric map, and the big advantage is you get it using the myocardial own properties of relaxivity. So you do not need to give contrast for this. So there are many patients we have realized that we just cannot give gadolinium to. One of them is renal dysfunction. So you can still get tissue characterization by using the T1 map. Basically, it is done in a single breath hold. You have about 17, between 9 and 17 heartbeats. You get the individual T1s, and then that is digitally pixelated and put into a map, which we call a T1 map. Now, the T1 map has a range. The most important thing is to get your normals right. So the normal population has anything between 980 to about 990 or 1000. Whereas those patients with a low T1 are generally those with iron overload, or they have hemochromatosis, or they have lipid in terms of either lipoma or a lipomatous transformation like in a chronic myocardial infarction. Now the high T1s are generally those with the inflammation is there. So for example, amyloidosis, myocarditis, and acute MI, for example, these all have high T1s. Now while it is very nice and you get very colorful images, the problem is the standardization. So the T1 unfortunately depends on a number of features. One is which scanner you use, is it 1.53, what are your normals for your institute for that scanner, for example, and that's the way it generates the map. So you need to have those normals. Now ECV is a step further, and ECV requires contrast to be given. So ECV is calculated based on the T1 that you get before the contrast. You give the contrast and again do the T1. So based on the ratio of pre and post contrast, you develop what is called ECV maps. They don't have a value, and because of that, they can be used across systems and they are more sort of reliable. But the basic thing is looking into the interstitium and quantifying the interstitium more than gadolinium. And the big advantage here is that gadolinium is very good for focal diseases, whereas ECV gives you, when there is a diffuse disease, gadolinium does not get deposited. So the ECV gives you that picture.
Excellent. So we have a regular Cine MRI showing us the functions and volumes, and now we have myocardial characterization with the T1 maps, T2 maps, ECV, and also by the late gadolinium enhancement. Now we have a patient of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So from the history, from looking at the characteristic ECG and from the echo, we diagnose the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So I'll ask Dr. Alpa, when this patient is sent for a cardiac MRI, what incremental information I get from the cardiac MRI for the clinical management of these patients?
Okay, so we are here talking of a patient who is already diagnosed with HCM. One big role that cardiac MRI is to identify areas of scarring and quantifying those. There are very specific numbers. If you have a myocardial scar burden of more than 15%, it is a high-risk patient for arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death. So these are the patients whom you would definitely want to think of a preventable ICD. Other than that, you can also follow them up if they do not have scar, they fall in the moderate risk. So MRI on by identifying late gadolinium enhancement can pick up the high-risk cases. Also, there are cases where, you know, you because the echo may not be able to see the apices very well, there is a subset which gets identified purely on the MR with an apical aneurysm, with or without mid-myocardial obstruction. There may be apical thinning, apical aneurysms, and thrombus. This can be picked up on the MR. These are also, again, very high-risk cases. So these also become candidates for ICD implantation, preventable ICD. So again, MR can prognosticate those who already are known as HCM. Besides these, we can also have family members of these patients who are not symptomatic or who have not yet manifested. So again, MR, a baseline MR, especially in adolescents, it is recommended every year, and then after the age of 20, every 5 years, to identify whether they are developing into a phenotypical case of HCM because of our existing family history. So again, MR can pick up even before gadolinium enhancement comes in. You can pick up whether these patients are going to develop into HCM by seeing deep crepes or elongation of mitral valves, leaflets. So these are certain characteristics which are easily picked up on the MR. Identifying even those who are as of now phenotypically normal, but by genotype they are positive. So MR can have an incremental role in identifying high risk cases, as well as in helping identify cases who may develop HCM, and so you can monitor your treatment and prognosis on these cases. So definitely a big role, and I feel that HCM is one cardiomyopathy where every patient should have at least one baseline cardiac MR to assess scar burden and avoid sudden cardiac deaths.
It's true. It is said that every cardiomyopathy patient, irrespective of the morphology, should have at least one cardiac MRI in his lifetime. So I think that takes me to the next question, is that we are seeing more and more number of dilated cardiomyopathies. So I'll ask Dr. Christopher, how the cardiac MRI helps in the diagnosing of etiology of these dilated cardiomyopathy patients, and also how it helps in prognostication. And I think then we'll go ahead with the heart transplant.
Yes, so a dilated cardiomyopathy for long has been a waste paper basket diagnosis. So anything which you didn't know was put in as a DCM. So number one is we want to characterize this DCM. So while echo is great in identifying the dilated chambers, MR is very good in volumetric assessment, getting the RV especially. We know that prognosis is very much linked to the RV and diastolic volume index. So MR gives you those volumes, whether it's atrial volumes, RV volumes, LV volumes, and takes care of that. This is also to be used in a longitudinal fashion over 6 months or 1 year to see the progress of various drugs and interventions. The second thing is it teases out to a great extent the etiology of the DCM. So DCM is basically the final pathway for a host of diseases. So most diseases end up as a DCM, as a last thing. So if you want to look at etiology, MR is a great tool because it first of all segregates the ischemic versus the non-ischemic. We know the ischemic ones are the ones at high risk. So the so-called DCMs, when we feel that there's a subendocardial pattern of scar, they actually are ischemic patients who have been left alone and then they've progressed. So they need to be handled separately, and MR gives you that information. The second group is those patients who don't have the ischemic underlying etiology and non-ischemic. Even those patients, we can roughly tell you, just short of a immunohistochemistry diagnosis, as to what the probable etiology. And here is where the scar pattern on the DCM, as Dr. Alpha has already discussed, really helps us. So specific scars, for example, the basal septum, tell us that the etiology is possibly sarcoid. If you have an infralateral subepicardial scar, they're generally more likely to be myocarditis as the precipitating factor. Or if you have a typical septal midwall, these are the original so-called idiopathic DCMs, familial DCMs. So it really helps out in the etiology. And once you get the scar pattern, it also helps the clinician focus a biopsy, which we know can be extremely important in finding out the underlying pathology based on the scar. So if the scar is, for example, on the septal aspect and it's more towards the RV, it becomes easy, technically less challenging, to get a good piece of biopsy, and then based on the histochemistry you can do that. So etiology is one. The second thing is, the moment you have a scar of any kind of significance, the prognosis automatically changes. So a DCM patient with a normal RV, they do very well. Actually, they do very well with medical management. But the moment they start develop a scar, they're at high risk. They're at high risk for sudden cardiac death. They're high risk for sudden for hospitalizations and death. So these are patients that need to be aggressively seen. We know that ICDs on these patients are still not as effective as the ischemic group, but still we can focus our therapies based on these patients. Lastly, as I said, DCM, the prognosis. Again, now that we're using the T1 maps on these patients, we pick up the DCMs very early. We pick up the etiology very early. Even where there is no gadolinium, we see a DCM, we feel like giving a good prognosis to the patient. But the T1 and the ECV maps that we talked about actually tell us that this process is actually diffuse, this process is there, and this needs to be addressed. And if you look at the gadolinium, there's no gadolinium. So early pickup of disease and early stratification is very important.
Excellent. So MRI is actually giving us a lot of information of the extracellular space. We know also whether there is a replacement fibrosis, so on and so forth. So can we use this knowledge when there is a, say, acute rejection in cardiac transplant patient, or if there is a chemotherapy induced myotoxicity? So the question is open to both of you. So whether this particular technology of MRI to look into the extracellular space expansion and the myocardial replacement, can it be used to pick up the rejection or the chemotoxicity?
Yes, in acute rejection, the first thing that becomes prominent is the increase in the ECV. That can be easily identified on the MR. In fact, most of the studies that have happened have shown very good correlation between appearance of acute rejection on biopsy as well as on the MR. MR has the advantage that it is not a localized thing. You're seeing the entire myocardium. Whereas when you're doing a biopsy, you may not be able to capture those areas which may be actually going into a subtle changes of a subclinical rejection. So increase in ECV volume is definitely a criteria which has been very strongly propagated, although we need much more larger multi-center trials. Other factor where MR will score is that the inter-observer variability in assessment of ECV is very good, because it's more on values, it's more objective, whereas when you're sending the biopsy report for pathological correlation, you may have a wide variation because it's, again, it's a subjective opinion. So that's where the MR will score, especially when it comes to diagnosing acute rejection in the first year and in the early phases where you're only seeing increase in the ECV. So I think Dr. Johanan wants
to add. There's a wide variation. In fact, there are places in the US centers who have almost given up on EMBs except for very specific things, and they're using MR. And on the other extreme is in a country like ours, where these parametric images are just coming in. We were just talking the last 2 days in the meeting that we would like to do MRs immediately post-discharge when we know the patient is clinically stable, maybe with an EMB also, and then carry it out every 3 months, so that you're very clear, you're doing the EMB, you're doing the T1 mapping, you're doing the ECV, and you're having concordant results. Once you have enough confidence in that space, that's when, especially after a year is over, any possible rejection clinically, you will only depend on the MR. And if you're doing it in the same center, same machine, with his pre-existing T1 values, which you've already got serially, they make a very powerful tool to pick it up early. And when you're seeing the T1 or the ECV high in a specific area, the biopsies can be focused there if possible, and that will give you a high yield, okay, rather than just going to the septum, which may not be involved.
Excellent. And I think to sum up, actually, the chief editor of JSCC, Dr. Valentin Fuster, says that MRI still has not hit the ceiling. So there are so many new things will keep on coming into the MRI field. So Dr. Johan, where do you think the MRI, cardiac MRI, is heading to?
Yes, we are heading to a one-stop shop in imaging. The protocols are getting better, the speed is getting better, we are getting parallel imaging. So I truly believe it's a great tool for the simple reason there is no radiation. And we are moving into a world where we want to be as safe as possible for the operator and the patient. So MR truly has all those answers. It's just a question of when the technology will be able to sort of rise up and be also cost effective. So right from coronary imaging to scar imaging to parametric imaging, you have almost everything. And now there are people doing interventions on the MR. So I think it's a work in progress, but we are heading in the right way.
Thank you. Thank you, panelists, for giving us an extraordinary insight into the cardiac MRI in heart failure. Thank you.